Hey, you made it through 2020, and that's definitely something to thank God for. But still struggling with a little something? Don't worry, I've got you. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to Faith with the Fox Family. I know it's just one fox today, but that's because my wonderful husband is out getting some extra bacon for us, so I appreciate him dearly. He is working right now, so you'll just get me today, but hopefully that's good enough. So I came on here today because I just wanted to take some time to encourage you. I don't know if you may be dealing with COVID, one of your family members might be dealing with COVID, or any other sickness or disease. You know, recently my mother was diagnosed with COVID-19 on the 10th of December. And I tell you, although our faith is strong in the Lord, this has been a difficult predicament. But again, I say our faith is strong in the Lord, and I've just been so grateful that throughout this time, when I shift my focus from, you know, the fear of this disease to the faithfulness of God, oh my goodness, He has just shown up in so many great ways. And so I wanted to come on here because a lot of times when our family members are ill, the relatives that are at home praying for them are often forgotten. And I don't say that to talk about anyone, but I just want to lift you up today because, you know, personally, I have been placed in a role that was quite shocking. I don't know if you know, but when your relative is ill with COVID-19 and they're placed in the ICU, they only allow two specific family members to call to even check up on your relative, as well as they immediately have the patient sign a form that states, you know, name two people that can make decisions on your behalf just in case you are unable to. And so that's where me and my sister has found ourselves in this time. I was listed as the first person to make decisions on my mother's behalf, but we were hit with so many different surprises. One being the most dramatic, or the most hurtful one, is that when we initially was made aware that my mother had decided this, they told us, but don't worry, should your mother's situation becomes dire, you will have the decision to make to whether to intubate her or not. And so I know they said, don't worry, but immediately you go through in your mind, like, oh my goodness, am I ready to make that decision if need be? Would I be able to make the best decision for my loved one? And then come 2 days later, they flipped the script. So we already had to deal with that, okay? The pressure of that. And then come 2 days later, they say, oh no, we got your mother's consent and we're gonna do it whether you approve it or not, because we really don't need your approval. So within 30 minutes of them intubating my mom, we were informed. And when I tell you that was a really hurtful time, you know, words cannot even express. And then not to mention, it occurred on my anniversary. So needless to say, we've been experiencing a lot, but again, I say that God has been faithful. And so I just wanted to, again, come on here to encourage, you know, family, you know, to the one who's having to make decisions or to, you know, relay the information, I pray for you. You know, I don't even know you, but my heart goes out to you because there had been some days where, I couldn't even get the words out of my mouth without crying. And no, it wasn't due to a lack of faith, but more so due to your heart bleeds for the person. Because my mother was talking, eating. In fact, the day before, when they decided that they couldn't feed her in order to keep the breathing, the BPAP machine on her, she was, you know, telling them, "I'm hungry," you know. If you know my mother, you know she's sassy, so she allowed them to know exactly how she felt, you know. And so to you know, the natural eye, she seemed fine, you know. And then all of a sudden they tell you that she's unable to breathe on her own, and that's just a devastating feeling. And so I'll be honest with you and say that for the first 3 to 4 and maybe even 5 days of this, I cried myself to sleep every single night if I could get to sleep. You know, there were times where just before, you know, I was calling my family members to inform them, I would have a total breakdown, you know, and I was seeking to pray and read the word while being inundated with the doctor's understanding of how he felt the outcome would be for my mother, which was, I'll just be honest with you, not pleasant. And still to this day, I'm inundated with horrible news each and every day. And so I say that not to receive pity, but to say, if you're in that position, my heart goes out to you. And I just want, I beg and I plead for, you know, those who might be around someone who is having to go through this. Yes, please continue to pray for the person that's in the hospital, but definitely seek to reach out to the family member, you know, that's having to make the decisions. This is a very difficult situation, and I don't know if anyone feels prepared from the stories I've read about or seen on TV, you know, even a believer, especially. My heart went out to this one pastor. He said how when he got COVID, his congregation left him. That just broke my heart, because in some levels, this has been treated like how folks treat when they hear about you having a sexually transmitted disease. And don't get me wrong, by any means, I don't feel like people should get treated horribly when that occurs either. But they have definitely begun to demonize this thing. And, you know, I've heard so many stories of people, you know, being believers and, you know, yet getting it. People who take extreme precautions, yet getting it. And I'm not saying that to say that I don't have faith that God can protect you. But I'm just saying that when a person comes down with something, regardless of what it is, what sense does it make to demonize the person or to withdraw your support from their family? Like, for instance, I think at this moment, this will be the greatest opportunity for the church to minister to the loved one who's in the hospital, their family members, and get them to understand the love of God, even if they have it in their heart that they'll never step into a church. But you simply being kind, whether it be, you know, you purchasing a meal as the church, whether it be you just occasionally checking on the loved one, you know, or, you know, letting them know you have their back, that you're praying for them. You know, if you could send them to go get a massage. I know in these times, that's kind of difficult, you know, because we got to wear our mask and everything. But again, this is not something I'm asking for, but I've just been thanking God that even in this circumstance, the Lord has brought up opportunities for me to be a blessing to others that I find in this similar situation. And so that's really my reason for being on here today. Yes, we'll go into the word, and yes, we'll seek to encourage you, and yes, we've given you ideas on how you can support you know, loved ones who are having to make decisions on behalf of their loved ones. But ultimately, my plea is just to demonstrate love. And also for the person having to make decisions, don't beat yourself up. Because I'll be honest and say that even though me and my sister had no choice in the matter as to whether or not to intubate my mother, I felt extremely guilty, like I have failed her, because I know it's something that she did not want. It's something we didn't want, but we were helpless in the matter, you know? And so that's why I've just been so grateful for my relationship in God, because, and also just for those who have been supporting me, because I don't think I would have made it, you know, especially where my state of mind was initially, you know. But I'm so grateful for a personal relationship with God, because immediately He centered me and caused me to remember what I know, you know. Like I said, don't beat yourself up, you know. There are so many times where I just cry, like, I'm trying to do the best that I can, you know, and I thank God that I got still a moment. It was in the shower, you know, just to seek the Lord and hear His voice, because sometimes we can be so busy talking at God, declaring God's word, telling God what we believe He can do, you know, and then not wait for Him to talk to you. And I was so grateful for the moment when He said to me, you know, I don't want you, after you get off the phone with these doctors, to allow your disposition to change. And I tell you, that's very difficult to do, and you really got to practice it, especially as many times as these doctors tell you negative things, you know. Even I had to tell the doctor, you know, hey, you know, my mother's saved, so the potential for death part, that sting is gone, because she's going to be with the Lord either way. But I don't need you adding on to what the situation is, meaning if you're called to give a diagnosis or a report, then I don't then need you also to say, now, you know, most people don't live from this, or, you know, worst case scenario, this will happen or that will happen, that will happen. It's like, I didn't ask you for that. And not that I don't seek to hear the truth, but in a lot of conversations, it appears as though doctors and nurses try to stifle or constrict or utterly remove the hope, you know, you have for God to do His work, you know. And so I was so grateful the night when I was in the shower and the Lord was like, I don't want you to allow what man say to cause your disposition to change. You know, ultimately healing comes from God. Yes, and before you jump down my throat, I know that it is a good thing to seek doctors, to have medicine, because they work hand in hand with God's work. So that's not what I'm saying, but healing ultimately comes from the Lord. So you have to get yourself in a place where you solely want to hear what God says. Yes, don't be a fanatic or religious and tell the people, don't speak that over me. No, because the effect is when you believe it. So they can say whatever they want to say, but you have to allow God's voice to be louder. And so again, listening to His voice and then just, you know, reading the word and praying, you know, and looking at stories of survivors, that has really been an encouragement to me. And as well as doing kind deeds, you know, this circumstance would have you want to just roll up in the ball, you know, and just basically die from the sadness, because not only are you having to deal with your emotions, but when you do allow yourself to receive calls from others, they'll say, why did you allow that to be done to your mother? Or, oh no, that's the circumstance. Oh no, you know, and that can really affect you. And so, in many cases, I have had to do like Jesus and put folks out, you know. This is why I didn't choose to do things in a normal manner. And this might help you as well if you're the contact person. What I did, because initially in the first week, I was trying to be strong for everybody. And I was calling everyone, you know, I was seeking to encourage folks. I was, even though I was having a breakdown, you know. But then, you know, the Holy Spirit told me to pick one of my mother's aunts and just relay the information to her via text. And that way I wasn't continuously in an emotional state. And so that has been a blessing, as well as when you are present in the moment, you know, not solely seeking God because you expect a certain outcome. Again, I'm not doing this because I'm trying to sway God's hand. I stand on God's promises, you know, and I believe that salvation and healing is hand in hand. And just like I believe that God is the King of Kings, kings have oaths that they stick to. So that's where my faith lies. Now, you don't have to believe as I believe. I'm not forcing anything down your throat, but I'm just saying that's where my comfort and my encouragement comes from. But what I mean by stay in the moment is, if you are solely considering like, okay, God, I've prayed this long and I've fasted this long, I'm expecting you to do something. And then, like in my situation, you're every single day inundated with negative reports. Oh, that's going to tire you out real quick and cause you to lose hope and faith, is if that's where it lies in. Know that this, we trust in the potency and the power of God. And I personally don't believe that just because you pray and fast that God has to move. What I believe that prayer and fasting does is remind you of God's truth and also realigns you into positioning yourself to solely trust in God's ability. Not your own, not what you can do, not what you've seen happen in the past. Because we think about, even the word lets us know that even in a time when Jesus walked this earth, you know, he let us know that his will was to provide salvation, to forgive folks of their iniquities, and to heal folks from their sicknesses and disease. But what happened? When he went to his own town, the Bible strictly tells us that he couldn't do many miracles. He couldn't heal many people because of their unbelief. So again, that's what prayer and fasting does. It aligns you to believe that Jesus can and will do it. And that's simply it. It's nothing about us that moves God, you know? And that's just what I believe. Again, I just stand on his word and his truth. But again, being my point was to be present, because when I've taken my focus on God, you got to do it this way, and I need you to do this, and bring her out today and recover her now, and I've just been present in the moment, I've been able to appreciate how he has allowed people that I hadn't talked to for years to show up and encourage me every single day, to be there, you know, to answer questions if they had knowledge in the field, or to, you know, send me small, you know, treasures. Like my sister-in-law, on the third day, I think, that we were going through this, she sent me a cozy blanket. And I tell you, in the moment, that meant everything to me. So again, when we are present and constantly seeking to abide in the Lord, we're not so much caught up on outcomes or how God has to do it, but we just stand on His word, and that way we're able to be a blessing as well as be blessed. Because I'll tell you, the trick of the enemy is to get you bitter, to have you saying, oh, folks didn't check up on me, oh, you know, there's been people that have gone through similar situations and I walk through with them daily, or they had hard life experiences and I was there, I provided a meal, I gave them gifts, I prayed for them, you know. And that's foolishness, because when you get caught up on that, guess what you're doing? You're putting you above God, and that's not necessary. God will oftentimes, and I just read this recently on Instagram and it blessed me, put you in situations by yourself so that you know, hey, God is there. And if you've got God, you've got all you need. So don't waste your time, you know, on hangups, you know, who's doing this. Now, of course, situations will reveal, you know, your foundation and whom you can put your trust in, but that's not a weapon. That's just for you to see, and that's simple. But again, you want to take this time to forgive people, you know? How can you expect the Lord to do anything when you can't do what He's asking you to do? You know, when you think about even before you take communion, if you've got an ought against your brother, you need to forgive them. And I'll give an example as to how I had to come through that. Okay, so I think it was the first night that they decided to intubate my mom. I got into an argument with my dad. And so immediately, I just wanted to fuss and be done with it.
But God began to speak to me and tell me, do you really want to have that on your heart while you're going through this? And so, you know, I had to repent of, you know, seeking to hold that. And I called my dad back and began to discuss it. And I told him, you know, I don't want this to be a time where I hang up on you and never talk to you again, or don't talk to you for a season or a time, but I would like to fix this with you. And so that was just the beginning through this circumstance of times where I've had to check my own heart, you know, because you don't want to be in a place where you're holding on to unforgiveness. If you have something against your family member, well, you got to release that, because if not, it will make it very difficult to pray. You don't want that to be a lie that the enemy uses in order for you not to get a prayer through, because you have set barriers before you and God. So again, it's just a good thing to recognize when you need to release things in order to be free enough to receive what God is saying and doing. I think that a lot of times when situations like this occur, family members and people in your life will stray or seek to stay away, because they don't, and especially within the church, they don't want to get involved and, you know, and begin to pray and then say certain things. And then if the outcome doesn't occur the way you are expecting or they have declared, then they feel ashamed or they feel like they failed you. And the thing is, this is solely a work of God, you know. And so you don't have to feel like your relative or your friend or your church member doesn't want to hear from you. There's many ways that you can let them know that you're there for them. It could be via card, it could be via gift, it could be via, you know, a text message or a a video message to them. You know, we all have, in most people's phone, there's a voice to text option or a voice recording. You can let the person know they're just on your heart. And if you simply call and say, is there anything I could do for you? You know, that's just demonstrating once again the love of God. But if you don't receive that, you be that. You get in someone's life that you can be an encouragement to, even if you feel like you gotta fake it initially. You know, just get going. Just start. Just be kind. Seek to be extra generous. You know, do what you can in order to not allow this circumstance to kill you. Okay? So, another thing that I've been seeking to do is take communion. And that's just to remind me of God's promises and how he has given us all sozo, you know, salvation. He's rescued us, redeemed us, you know, salvaged us. And so basically I'm just reminding myself of the truth. I've also been listening to Joseph Prince and Joyce Meyer, you know, and Marilyn Hickey. And not that I'm putting my faith or trust in man, but simply those who take God at his word, and that's just it, you know. And declaring that over myself anytime fear tries to cause me to react, you know, because to deny that you don't get afraid or to force yourself not to cry because you feel like you're not in faith, that's the trick of the devil to wear yourself out. Also, you know, keep up with your self-care. Drink plenty of water. Work out. You know, I know initially when this first happened, I was losing weight in all the wrong ways. It was due to stress. I think I lost like 12 pounds over a weekend. But now, you know, I've gotten to the point where this situation has inspired me, and I walk at least 2 miles a day. And that is not only beneficial for your body, but to help anxiety. Like, yes, I am praying. Yes, I am believing. There's nothing within me that doesn't believe that God can't or won't do this. But ultimately, I'm also considering that I am part body. And I have to ensure that my mental is together, my physical health. You know, when this first happened, I was crying so much that I think I got a touch of strep throat or something, because my throat began to burn, and I was sick, feeling sick. And I had to step out on faith and go ahead and get tested for COVID. I praise God that it was negative. But I'm just saying, you have to take care of your body, because this is a stressful situation, and you don't want to, you know, be so inundated with what you're experiencing that you, you know, basically stress yourself out to where you harm yourself. So again, stay in the Word. You know, one of my favorite chapters that I've been focusing on is Mark chapter 5, and I really encourage you. You know, there's so many you know, great experiences of healing that will just encourage you, you know. And what I've been doing is, because I don't want to believe that COVID or any other disease is more powerful, like God's not able to heal that, you know. So this is why I've been reading like the difficult circumstances in the Bible, to where if God didn't intervene, this person or that person was not going to recover. And so this has been such a blessing to me. For example, you know, the man who, you know, had you know, demons. He was demon possessed, you know, and everyone was able to note his behavior, but there was no one able to help him. And so I just praise God that, you know, the Lord allowed that actual experience to be in the Bible, you know, because right now the doctors don't know what to do. And this is no, you know, jab at them. But this is the perfect situation for the Lord to show himself strong. And then I think about the woman with the issue of blood, you know, and how, you know, I don't knock her because obviously she had faith. I believe that she put her trust in doctors initially, but she clearly saw herself healed. So again, I don't knock her, but I love how the Bible said she had gave up all her money to receive how she saw herself, you know, which was healed, but was none the better but the worse. And that's how this situation has felt like, you know, like I said, my mother appeared on the outside to be just fine, you know, and over time it has just appeared in the natural to get worse in accordance to what the doctors are saying. But I like how, just like the woman with the issue of blood, she realigned the focus of her faith and made it Jesus and his ability. It's like, you know, doctors will seek to do their best, but healing comes from God. And so that's what I have sought to do in this circumstance and in every situation and circumstance in my life. Seek healing from God. And so it's just been, like I said, very hard, you know. There was a moment where Mom was close to being with the Lord, you know. It was an extremely hard day, but see, this is how God will do amazing things in your life. In that moment when my sister called me, because the doctor called her and was like, your mom's in cardiac arrest. And the beauty of all of this is that when my sister called me, there was like a peace that came over me, and I just sat there. I said, you know what? Everything's gonna be okay. Let's pray. And I began to declare God's word. And I tell you, it wasn't anything about me, but just simply God's ability to bring you peace in that moment is so powerful. So this is why I'm saying that in these circumstances, when you're being talked to like a dog, from the doctors and the nurses, or you're being mistreated, you put your trust and your everything into God, because he is a keeper and he's able to keep you from losing your mind, from losing your peace, and just abide in him. And so again, I just want to encourage you today. Also, what I've been seeking to do is I place like 10 scriptures in my phone, and each and every day I seek to declare the scriptures over my mom and every single patient in the ICU and the doctors and the nurses, because, you know, I told my aunt one time, I'm like, I wouldn't mind if there was a news story where every single person on that floor miraculously was healed. You know, why not? See, because God's in the business of doing big things, you know. And sometimes when life gets hard, we lose our faith in him, and we sometimes, you know, demote his capabilities, you know, or his power, you know. But I'm just like this, why not? You know, why not her? Why not them? Why not this circumstance and this situation? You know, I'm just crazy enough to believe him for it, you know, or as they say, I ain't got enough faith not to believe him. And so again, I didn't come on here to bash anybody or to point out anyone specifically in my life, because I have not even experienced most of what I've talked about, but I've heard other people's, you know, testimony or them attest to what they've experienced. And I just wanted to see if I can provide any hope in this circumstance. Like I told you, I've been doing, I've just been taking my phone taking some scriptures, you know, considering all that God has done and said he would do, and that he's kings of kings, he's a king of kings, Lord of lords, and that he keeps his promises. And I've just been trusting him, and I just encourage you to do so. So I lift up you right now. I lift up every patient around the world who's experiencing it. I lift up every family member. I pray for your encouragement. I pray for every doctor, every nurse, to remain safe in this situation, to be encouraged, to be strengthened, and also to allow their words to be of God, to allow God to speak through them, to not seek to take out folks' hope. In accordance to Isaiah 53 and 5, the word declares, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed." Our loved ones are healed. Psalms 103 and 3 declares, "Who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases." Our loved ones are healed. Luke 9 verse 2, "And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick." We've been sent to preach this, the kingdom of God, the word, and to heal the sick. Our loved ones are healed. Matthew 4 verse 23, "And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all manner of sicknesses and all manner of diseases among the people." Our loved ones are healed. And finally, in Psalms chapter 107 and 20, verse 20, the word of God declares, "He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions." Our loved ones are healed. And I just pray for your encouragement. I pray that you would stay strong in the power of his might, and that you would just seek his face in this situation. And if you got to shut some folks out, do that also, because you don't need anyone at this time telling you what they believe is going to happen who hasn't talked to the Lord. But also in remembrance of the Lord and how he allowed himself to be placed on the cross, was bruised for us, and how he declared that we do this in his remembrance. As his body was broken, he traded healing for our sicknesses and diseases. And so we do this in remembrance. Take and eat. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For his blood that was shed and got us victory, we do this in remembrance. We keep our mind focused on you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And so let's praise him like we believe him.